The Shawshank Redemption came to theater screens in the summer of 94. It didn't look like much to general audiences, who rather wanted to buy another box of chocolates than watch the film with the weird poster. That was their first impression of the film. In a short time, it accrued a massive interest from people. That's all it takes, really. Interest and time. That and a big goddamn television network to air it frequently. Good thing, too. This film has it all. Fine acting, brilliant writing, posh cinematography, and universal themes of hope that continue to inspire and keep people coming back to the walls of Shawshank Prison.
The story of redemption begins with the false imprisonment of one Andy Dufresne, played by Tim Robbins, convicted of murdering his cheating wife in a drunken rage, leading to incarceration in Shawshank Prison for life. Inside the walls, he meets and befriends Red, played by Morgan Freeman, the prison scrounger who doesn't invest much in hope as Andy does. Over the years, Andy and Red find ways to survive the prison system and begin to re-examine their own souls and what it means to be alive surrounded by massive walls and guard towers. Based on the novella Rita Hayworth and the Shawshank Redemption by Stephen King, the movie was adapted for the screen by writer and first-time feature director Frank Darabont. Seeing potential in the non-horror story from the horror king, he envisioned a film about two men who learn to love life and each other despite insurmountable odds. He also includes a theme of institutionalization to provide a thematic backbone and enrich the character development for Andy, Red, and the rest of the prisoners and guards. After securing a small budget from Castle Rock Entertainment, Darabont began casting the film and settling on a location in the Ohio State Reformatory in the town of Mansfield, Ohio. Casting proved to be difficult, with original choices Tom Cruise and Harrison Ford proving unavailable and uninterested. Eventually, Darabont settled on Tim Robbins for Andy and Morgan Freeman for Red. Robbins had a pretty spotty career before this film, appearing in the classic Bull Durham and the despised Howard the Duck. Andy is portrayed as an emotionally repressed man who eventually grows a greater appreciation for life and reignites a fire under himself to make a break for it. This movie changed the direction of his career for the better, and eventually he won the Oscar for Clint Eastwood's Mystic River. The original character of Red was a red-haired Irishman, but Darabont was so taken with Morgan Freeman's approach to the character that he cast him instead. Even including the Irish joke in the screenplay, which gives Red a nice bit of humor in his introduction to Andy in the courtyard. I don't think I need to say much more about Morgan Freeman, as he has proved himself a Hollywood legend in countless other roles. And long before he narrated The Marching Habits of Penguins, he narrates this film, which up there with Goodfellas might be one of the best uses of voiceover narration in a feature film. Freeman earned an Oscar nomination for this movie, and just like Robbins, would win an Oscar for another Clint Eastwood masterpiece, Million Dollar Baby. The supporting cast is rounded out with amazing character actors who know how to step into a role and knock them out of the park. Bob Gunton was born to play the corrupt and hypocritical Warden Samuel Norton, a man who acts as a selfless servant of God and the people, but is in reality a nasty villain, willing to kill to keep himself above everyone, as his power in the prison has allowed him. Clancy Brown makes for an intimidating guard Hadley, who is the first to give Andy some new power over the course of the story. The prisoner cast is benefited by the likes of William Sadler as the sardonic and hot-headed Haywood, who eventually warms to Andy over the years, and screen veteran James Whitmore as the old institution-dependent Brooks Hadlin, who earns one of the most emotional moments in the entire film. Behind the camera, Darabont was able to secure the talents of now legendary filmmakers. The most vital element behind the scenes was cinematographer Roger Deakins. Deakins was on the cusp of becoming a major director of photography in the American film industry, previously making a name for himself in British films, like Michael Radford's adaptation of 1984, and had replaced Barry Sonnenfeld as the primary cinematographer of the Coen brothers, beginning with the film Barton Fink. This film earned him an Oscar nomination, one he should have received the statue for, by the way, and is now the most respected cameraman in the industry. Editor Richard Francis Bruce was an industry veteran who had worked for the likes of George Miller and Peter Weir. This film marked his first of several Oscar nominations, and more high-profile film editing gigs throughout the 90s and early 2000s. Composer Thomas Newman made his big break with this film as well. Coming from an elite family of musicians that include the great Alfred Newman and Lionel Newman, along with brother David and cousin Randy, Thomas chose a more subtle way of writing his music, which makes him stand out amongst his siblings. Relying heavily on piano and strings, he properly underscores the drama with the right dollop of poignancy only when it's needed. This is indeed one of his finest scores, and one worthy of his Oscar nomination. With all this being said, production was reportedly difficult, mainly coming down to two factors: a very tight shooting schedule, and the inexperience of Frank Darabont directing a feature. Freeman and Robbins in particular were often at odds with Darabont, insisting on multiple retakes without much correction. But both have claimed it was Darabont simply getting used to this sort of gig, and seemed to hold no ill will toward him. His insistence on wide scenic shots were also at odds with Deakins' insistence on fewer of these shots, as they would feel more special and heighten the claustrophobia of the prison scenes if shot tighter rather than wider. Despite all of this, it contains some of their finest work combined, and remains a film they're fondly remembered for, and with good reason. Shawshank deals with many interesting, often intertwining themes, and very thought-provoking material. This is typical of the best Stephen King writings, and subjects that Frank Darabont has carved a little niche out for himself in movies. The surface theme of the film is institutionalization, which can only make sense in a film about prison. As the years wear on for the prisoners, they evolve from hating the walls to eventually becoming dependent on those walls to function. Brooks is the character that best exemplifies the idea of not being able to process life on the outside of the prison once paroled. In prison since 1900, he has missed out on the last 50 years of development and cannot function without the routine and structure of life behind bars. In one of the most upsetting moments in all of film, he decides he just can't deal with this anymore and takes his own life in the halfway house. This theme is challenging and also tragically true, and the prisoners often don't know what to make of it. Some, like Haywood, don't believe it and ignore this idea of becoming dependent on the thing you hate, whereas Red firmly believes it is to be true and begins to dread the idea of parole more and more. All the while, Andy falls in as the arbiter of corruption by Norton, the warden of Shawshank. The story touches upon how prisoners are used as cheap labor and how one can profit off of this use of people for money. Norton eventually sets up programs that appear to be good to the people on the outside, but in reality fuels the power and corruption he and the guards constantly hang over the inmates. The warden is portrayed as a religious man whose piety supersedes his moral compass, even to the point of killing an innocent man to protect that power. Once it's about to be taken away, he can't handle it himself. Bob Gunton gives a bravura performance, and definitely missed out on an Oscar nomination for this role. This leads us to the best scene of the entire film. Andy and Red discuss life on the outside once more. Andy says he would go to Zihuatanejo, Mexico, and start life anew in a place with no memory. He even capitulates to the fact that the life he led, the way he carried himself and stifled his emotions, is what led to his wife's death. Even though he didn't do the physical killing of her, he is the one directly responsible in his mind. He would rather escape to a new life to redeem himself. Ritt still believes he can't function outside the walls, and at this point doesn't even know if he wants to. Andy delivers the signature line of the film. I guess it comes down to a simple choice, really. Get busy living, or get busy dying. Here, Andy has not given up on his hope and intends to bring his pipe dream to life. Thus, the next morning, after 20 years of covert digging, he escapes from Shawshank Prison. I firmly believe that this scene is the reason why Shawshank has resonance over the years. The theme of hope in this movie is particularly strong and prevalent. And what I like about it is that it wasn't played as a cloying checkbox for Oscar voters. It's discussed and analyzed by characters we like and care about in a setting ripe for the subject. They're all prisoners who are cynical about how they got in there and bury that feeling of hope inside as they trudge through routine and threat of the warden or the guards, in the hope that they can just die peacefully. When Andy shows up, he is not particularly special, but the more he expresses himself, he begins to figure out the way to his eventual freedom by deciding he would rather live than get crushed by Norton and become dependent on the walls. He redeems his soul by choosing to live and forge a new life, one better off because of his deep friendship with Red. Red, not to be outdone, runs an interesting emotional gambit through the story himself. He begins as someone who wants to leave Shawshank. He does get interviewed for parole twice and is denied twice before the climax. But who doesn't seem to mind being in there so much as the others? As more time passes, however, he begins to bond deeper with Andy, and he begins to resent the idea of hope as a fool's errand, as he's seen enough men at Shawshank, particularly Brooks, losing themselves to the institution. When he's interviewed for a third time, in a masterful shot set up by Darabont and Deakins, he has seemed to given up on being free, and callously responds to the parole board. Only then is he released. He goes through the same motions as Brooks, but that one spark of hope left by Andy is ignited, and he follows the same advice Andy followed, or as he puts it, get busy living or get busy dying. That's goddamn right. The chemistry between Andy and Red is a perfect combination of writing, directing, and chief among others, astonishing acting by Robbins and Freeman. Both are performances of great restraint by the two men, could have easily gone into extreme emotional acting to convey the themes and dialogue. Both actors have gone on to amazing success, and yet this film feels like the summation of their entire careers and how they work as actors. I simply can't imagine any others in these parts. Their friendship is indeed a special one that builds over the years, just as in real life, and they do intend to keep their promises to one another at the end, with one of the most perfect uses of the wide shot in all of cinema, in my opinion. Deakins was very much correct. By using these shots less, particularly this, it feels all the more special. The Shawshank Redemption was nominated for 7 Academy Awards without any wins. In all honesty, 1994 was a heavy year for movies, and the Academy more or less matched that. However, I would have definitely awarded Frank Darabont the Adapted Screenplay Oscar over Forrest Gump. This script has just aged better than that one. But for the rest of the ceremony, well, I'd have to dedicate a whole video to discuss that. But The Shawshank Redemption has endured on television and home video, and is widely seen as one of the great triumphs of American cinema. Even IMDb.com users rank it the top of their 250 greatest films list. Countless other artistic honors cemented its artistic value, even if it did not succeed commercially. This movie is very special, as it is a perfect cocktail of great writing, acting, and visual storytelling. Its simple message of hope, is something that especially resonates in these dark times. My final ranking, 10 out of 10.